Hey, Bat Buddies.
Paul Roberts, Artsy One here. We're going to finish up a few loose ends here. I'm already starting my new channel, but I'm going to keep doing stuff here because we're already established. I've done this before, but I'm going to take this thing and I'm going to go ahead and paint it up and make it look nice. Why not? It's sitting there in raw latex form. I want to take care of these loose ends. Somebody wanted me to help them out recently. And I want you all to know that, yes, I am always helping the Bat Buddies as I can. But right now I'm renovating the house and there's other things going on in my life. I'm not doing a whole lot of making things per se. Somebody wanted a cowl and he said, well, I saw it right up here. This is just one of my personal cowls up here. And this too. I don't keep a stock. I'm just a hobbyist. If I'm telling you I can't get latex, it takes me a month and a half to get it and costs the way up. That's the case. I was just down at Reynolds using some of my product that I use and buy in for 15 years or more. They say there's a shipping problem and it takes almost a half a year for that to get to me. We know that deep freeze about a year ago in Texas, that first kicked off the product's problems with silicones, resins, urethanes, different things that we use, and the shortages that that's created. It's caused things to go up. Latex, same way. But one of the things that's also happened, not the shipping container thing you heard about in LA, but the worldwide shipping issues, because a lot of people are out of work because they've got COVID, has caused a slowdown. It takes, they were telling me, a half a year for a product to come into reality and finally get to where it's there for me to go and get it. And by the time that's happened, I have to pay a lot more for it. And everybody else does too. We all understand that. So one of the things I'm doing right now is withdrawing a little bit from production. I don't know what the future is going to hold. I'm doing other things with my time, including spending this year with you guys. I'll still do some of this stuff. But I also want to do things like my other channel. And that's going to be more expansive, allowing me to do, oh, you're wondering, why am I not wearing my white t-shirt? I better be careful. I do anything today, I'll get it all messed up. This is how I normally look. Look, I'm not even wearing blue jeans. I was going to go out and do a 22-mile bike ride today, but the weather wasn't going to be as good. There's a storm rolling in, and you know about it. It's going across the nation, but it's going to be here too, and I don't like to ride in the gray skies. That's not what California's about, as far as I'm concerned. I got plenty of my gray skies in Baltimore, cold, dark, and gray. Hey! We put out a clip of our band song here back in college here. Wish the sun was here today. Anyway, that was my life back then. And my kids don't get it. They love the cloudy skies and all the different atmospheric conditions. I said, well, I got plenty of that earlier in my life. I normally don't wear a white t-shirt. I only wear a white t-shirt when I'm working. Maybe I better not work in this. My daughter's at school. This reminds me of her a little bit. I like it. She got it for my birthday. And then for Christmas, I'm wearing this shirt underneath. My favorite restaurant, the Pirate House in Savannah, Georgia. But for now, it's too cold in here. Anyway, this is what my desk normally looks like. Come on over. It's always a mess. I normally clean it up with a sneeze for you guys, but not today. But I've been redoing some molds. For some reason, people have been buying these different pistols that I do. And I asked my wife, why on earth do you think that is? More so than normal. It's still not lucrative, but I throw it in with different things I do. And she says it's because people are trying to buy things that aren't real weapons right now, just so that if anybody threatens them in their home because there's so much crime, that they can at least wield something. And I said, gee, I never thought of that. I guess it's possible. My college professor said one time somebody broke into his home and he didn't know what he was gonna do. He wasn't prepared. And he just yelled out in a loud voice, Martha, hand me the gun. And they laughed. Well, maybe some people think that if they do this, you know, and somebody's not armed, mostly teens, they want to get their hands on something, sell it at a pawn shop or online. These Facebook things that people go to and just other ways that people sell online are causing people to commit crimes in order to have something, to have an inventory. A lot of people don't sit here and make something and work hard. They just want, let's go do the quick grab. But let's talk about making something. So before I take this and start working on it with you guys, gotta clean this area up. So invariably, there's always the free TV I pick up. I bought a phone, yay. They wouldn't take my old one, they wouldn't give me anything for it, it wasn't worth anything. Redoing various molds. So my thought was, I could watch something while I'm working. Might keep me a little more cheered up, something to do, rather than just talking to you guys. People are still asking me to make these latex belts. I don't like doing it, because it takes so long for something that thick to cure. So let me go ahead and clear this up and we'll get started on the project for today. Found three Batman capes. Well, they're not really Batman capes, but they might as well be. Great big. pieces of fabric that I can work with. Use it for other things too, but this isn't even a sheet. This is some kind of huge black bedspread. Why do people throw things like this out? I don't know, but it doesn't matter. I will do something with it. Anyway, all right, so now let's get started. Here we are. This has to be washed up. I'm gonna plasti dip it, but I'm gonna do some more latex work with it first. I think I'll do some hand latex work before I plasti dip it, kind of give you an idea of how that works. We're gonna do a battle damaged cowl. This is a cowl that I did. I guess it was an imperfect. I already showed you with an electric knife how I can make some of the scoring lines and change some of the details in a way previous video. But today we're gonna go ahead and do something with it because it's sitting here. And I'm gonna go ahead and make it nice. If it's gonna be sitting here, I'm just getting tired of looking at stuff that's not that great. Let's get it fixed up. All right, here we go. Okay, I've got this light so that you can really see all the flaws. A major issue with flaws. One of the things I'm gonna do is try to lessen that a little bit by giving some rhyme and reason with the brush strokes, with some dry brush work underneath the plasti dip. So if you see a brush stroke or you see an edge or a line, it's going in a direction that you think it should. It seems like, oh, okay, maybe that's part of the finish. Now I could do this with spraying and other things, but what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to go over any byproducts or any problems with this right now, so that when I'm working on it later, I can add the problems back in. And if any byproduct is still showing, that's not a problem because I will take it and I will make it so that it looks like it's a part of what I do to it to battle damage it. So I'm paying attention as I go to doing dry brush technique in the directions that I think are appropriate. Without going down the deep crevices, I'm trying to cover over some of the surface flaws so that when I work on it, it'll look like everything I've done to it is supposed to be done. Kind of like the same thing I do with junk. If something doesn't come out right and you're working on it and you know it's not the way it should be, what you do is you spend a lot of time making it look like what it should be so that you're not wasting your time. And when I make a lot of things, I always have what I call imperfects or irregulars. People are always asking me for that. But what happens is as soon as I have one, I say, ah, this didn't come out the way I wanted. Let's let it go. And I let it go. I never have anything for very long because I don't have a need for it. I don't even have my own what I'd call perfect finished suit. I've actually changed the way that I think about this whole hobby through the years. I don't want to say I've been there and done that, but I've been a lot of places and done a lot of things. So what I want to do now is do some of the things that I haven't done. And one of the things I haven't done is spend as much time as I would like with the Bat Buddies. And I don't emphasize that I can help them in ways of like acquiring things. I emphasize that I can help them in ways of advice or working on whatever they're working on to make it better or making something from scratch. This to me is the only fun thing about it. Do you remember the lesson, the thingamajigs that I told about my first and second grade? If it isn't that much fun, it isn't worth doing. So that is basically ready to have plasti dip applied. Let's go dry it. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take some silver and I'm gonna load up the brush and I'm gonna hit some of the edges. I did a little bit of this before I turned the camera on because I thought it was focused properly and it wasn't. But what I'm trying to do here is I got inspired by the video game, playing the video game. And one of the reasons why I wasn't able to get a lot of people interested in this cowl is because I think a lot of people played the video game with other skins over the character, but not me. I played it with this the whole time. And one of the things I liked is, in order to make it look dynamic when the rain or smoke or light flares or whatever would hit it, it would show so many shines. It was made out of different things. And I'll go in and try to do some of that, simulate some of that. And you know, you go to a convention or you're outside or at a birthday party and it just looks so dull, you know? What I try to do is I'm trying to imitate something's being rubbed away or something's underneath, or there's a sheen that the lighting effect of the game is actually you're carrying it with you. I believe this would be a really boring cowl if it wasn't for that. I like that, like the lighting effects in like those last Star Trek films. There was always like, you know, great lights coming through and stuff like this. And I just like that feel. I like the feel of the video game. So I'm gonna go and we'll start off with that. Just give it this feeling that there's something going on there. There's a sheen.
It's not just jet black.
Maybe it's not even battle damage yet. Maybe it's just there's something coming through from use. Or maybe the light and the sheen is just hitting it. The rain
or just the smoke and the different things. You're carrying the light with you from the video game. When you're at a convention and you're in the light of just a fluorescent light, or you're outside, I just think just a black cowl just doesn't work. I like to see things happening with it. I loved that game, and I played the whole game with this cowl. I didn't use other skins, and one of the reasons there hasn't been a lot of interest in this from my bat buddies is because they probably played it with other skins, and they never got really fell in love with this cowl like I did. But the idea is that there's just stuff going on it as the light hits it. You take that light with you. I like to just kind of work with that a little bit before I get into the battle damage stuff. Now, one of the things I do is I'll go and rough it up like that. And then I'll say, you know what? There's certain areas that I want to look different. Certain areas I don't want to have that. Maybe underneath the eye. And I'll lessen it. I've showed you this on utility belts before. Just areas I said, oh, I wish I didn't go so hard. Just give it a feeling like, it's not even that you don't think you did something right. It's just that you want to do things differently. Mm-hmm. You want to have it look like, oh, a lot of different things have happened to this. Not just one technique, but different things. Like the sunken cheekbone, maybe it didn't hit there as much. You know, stuff like that. Oh, but I like that swoosh, so I want to leave that. So I won't touch that. And maybe across there, there's a lessening or a fade. Different things like this. Just give it a feel so that it looks like you've worked it several times. And then also for this particular cowl, I like the fact that there's blue and red lights shining on it. And you just give it an indication that there's something that makes it where it's not black all the way. Just go back over that with your brush that's pretty dry. And you just spread that around. Maybe a little silver comes off because of the thinner on it. And we're ready to go to a different light now and do some different things. But you get an idea what we're doing here. And again, I just want to just so subtly hit this with some different things that aren't black. Barely be able to perceive it. And you remember, now there's gonna be battle damage on top of this. Don't worry about hitting it too much. You can come back with black. Let's go too much right there, okay? Too much, too much. Just simply hit it down, just like that. One of the things I like to do is get some stuff that's kind of echoing the lines. A little bit. Just, what is it? Who knows? It's what an artist would do. You kind of see this as filling in the connect the dots. Like, maybe there's like some contraction and expansion there. Maybe when he moved, like this gave. And I don't know, it operates on its own. In addition to whatever type of work he's doing in the field. Look at that, I made a mess. No problem. I like that big one there. Happy accident, right? Quite frankly, I was wanting to go in there and work anyway and make that a different kind of a black. Because this is like made out of a different kind of material. Now I'm using Plasti-Dip here, and I probably should have reached for my black spray paint because the thinner in the Plasti-Dip doesn't work the same. So let me take a Q-tip with some regular black and hit that. Okay, soften that up right away. Just went away, okay, blend it in. That's because the thinner that's in the spray paint is different than the thinner that's in the Plasti-Dip. So that's one of the things I'm just showing you to make you aware. I'm gonna do the same thing here. I'm gonna take some of that black. And whatever overspray I had, I'm gonna lessen it by coloring that in. Now, I've got other things to do. Let's go ahead and have some fun here. Let's go ahead and get this blue mixed in with the silver. Let's go ahead and load up our magic knife, our all powerful knife, this is what Bill Alexander would say. And go ahead and, like I was saying on the other side, echo some of these lines. Just give it some feeling of, there's a slash right there I did with the electric knife. Go ahead and add to that slash. There's some 3D quality coming through, and then there's some painted quality coming through. So wherever I say, oh, that was something I did when I demonstrated what you could do with the electric knife, look for anywhere else that you think might be a good spot for that. Some of these lines on here, they're kind of subtle. Maybe a few of them have another mark. I love these lines here. A lot of times I'll echo those further up, and you don't know where the indented line ends and where the line of the mark you're making begins. So you have an indent down here, and then when you go up a little bit further, you have this mark going along here, but there's no indent up there. It doesn't go up there. When you hit it different ways, different things happen. Look at that. That's bold. I like that. I'm not gonna do that in the exact same place, but I'm gonna do it again. Bold. We're not gonna go bold everywhere because then it'll look too junked up. But sometimes. Now, I can't usually work these if I'm trying to get rid of them as an imperfect, and somebody needs to say, hey, I'll take it off your hands. I can't spend a lot of time. But you can. You can spend as long as you want. But I can't do it because then what am I doing? I'm painting imperfect masks for the rest of my life. And that doesn't work. There's a place for everything that I do in this hobby. And there's a place for it not to be. What I do on my own is give somebody something to put in their hands that they can do something with, or something very much like they don't have and that other people aren't offering. And then even if they take this from me in this state, they can do more to it, or they can start from one that's fresh and do it. Or some people just like the plain black. I have not offered one of these for, oh man, as long as I can remember. I just stopped fooling with stuff like this. We had COVID, we had various things, it just got in the way. And I just went on to other things. But some people are asking me about it and kind of reminding me, let's do this video. So I am, for what it is. But I'm not gonna work on this to the nth degree today. I'm just giving you some ideas. And then you can do it yourself. Take the black, put a mark. Don't always have the light marks be the marks. This part where we went too red, maybe there's some other type of texture showing through. You could barely see that, but it's there. You wanna take different colors and you wanna do different things. Let's say I have just black here. I went too red there. Little indent of black there. Here's all the way black, but now all of a sudden I'm smoothing it. This is smoother and it's giving it a different feel than what was there. A lot of times I'll go around when I want more subtlety and I say to myself, oh, you went and did too much here. You got heavy handed. You go, okay, no problem. That's all red along there. Let's just say it's only red below this line. And then above this line, there's artifacting and the red goes away. Now all of a sudden, there's a seam there instead of just red. Oh, there's a red spray. No, I have created this line allowing it to say, no, something else happened here than what happened here. That's the kind of thing we like to think about as we work. And then sometimes I just go, well, the areas are just starting to look just too much all kind of similar. What else can I do? Let me take a little bit of this blue and black and say, okay, whatever's happening here on this little panel right here, it's its own thing. Maybe there's room for it here. Sure enough, there is, because look at that. It goes red, but now I'm stopping it from going red once it hits this. Now that becomes its own shape. Now, what I'm showing you here is very crude work, and it's crude on purpose to show you why crudeness can be used to your advantage. Kind of like, you know, Bill Alexander, you know, Bob Ross. They know what works, and they get it working fast. In a lot of ways, I've got to do that. I've got to make this hobby pay for itself. And I would like to make it worth my while sometimes. So what I do is I'll do things that are generic that I know that I can openly just say, here, this is available, guys. And then there's other things that are kind of like, well, this is an artistic work. It's a one of a kind, you know, that kind of thing. Occasionally I'll have that happen with an irregular. So I've gotten through these years doing a little of this, a little of that, you know, just little pieces, trying to stay small. Trying to stay irrelevant. That's one of the ways that I have been able to keep going with this stuff. Now let's see what this looks like on. So I've just given you some basic ideas of what you can do. Let's take a look at this close up in some really strong light. Now when I look at this on the side, I say that's just too red and too black. One of the things you can do is you can cause yourself little masking areas like this. And all of a sudden, lessen it a little bit if you think it's too much. Take a little off, put a little bit more back on. And then all of a sudden, that's a differentiation that wasn't there a minute ago. It was just too red for me. And it just made it look like I sprayed red on there. Now it looks like I sprayed blue on there, but let's go ahead and loosen that up. A little bit of this will be taken away a little bit. And when it dries, the sheen will be gone. Maybe this part here, inside here. But just say, okay, well, there's a bluer area right up there. Okay, take that off. That kind of thing. Now I'm just showing you techniques. You can do these, take your time. Before you know it, you'll have something that is your own unique creation. And every one of them is going to be this way. When I say this way, I mean different. They're all their own. And then what I like to do is I like to say, let's exaggerate wherever we make a change. Let's call attention to the fact that the change was made there. Try to lessen the idea that there was just an overspray there and say, no, there's not just an overspray. There's a division of armor wear on the cowl that accompanies that. Let's say you make an outright mistake like that. I don't like that at all. It doesn't look good. You can just simply rub it just like that with a little bit of lacquer thinner. Now it's gone. So as you're working on this, there's so many things you can do to make it your own. There's so many things. You could say, I overworked it there. I was heavy-handed. I don't want to be heavy-handed right there. I've got too much red on this back panel. No problem. Just take it off like an eraser, a magic eraser. Let's say I wanted to have some kind of a thing that went through here. All of a sudden, it does. What is that? I don't know, but at least it's not all red now. Maybe this one, I didn't want any of the red overspray on. Just wipe it off. There you have it. These are the kinds of things you can do when you're painting latex. And this is one of the reasons, or so many reasons, why I love latex. Because it is not only forgiving, it is calling for you. It is saying, do something with me. Make me unique. Don't make me like everybody else's cowl. Even though I'm shaped like it, because the sculptor took a long time to do this, I don't have to look like it. So that's what this video is about today, folks.
So a simple little video today, Bat Buddies, just to give you some ideas of what you can do with latex. And I'm just going to put this guy up here again because, hey, you know, I was getting tired of looking at oxidizing latex. I'll just put him up there. I'm not going to do anything more to it. I could, but it's good enough for my purposes. You are the guy that decides what's good enough for your purposes, Bat Buddy. Hopefully, your ideas can come from so many different places, including maybe a few that you might get from me. Bat Buddies, that's all I have for you today. I look forward to talking to you again on the next video. Make this about camaraderie, because I'm only doing this for that purpose, other than a creative outlet, of course. But now, like I say, my other channel is going to be my creative outlet. So this is now, let's keep this going. Let's make this special. Bat Buddies, I'm Paul Roberts, Artsy One.